Praise the Lord. Glory be to the Lord. I greet you
all in the loving name of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's good to see you all once again. Hallelujah. Every week when we come together, even though we cannot gather together in person. Hallelujah. But I strongly believe in spirit we are connected. Hallelujah. The Spirit of God, even though we are not, hallelujah, we are not worshiping physically, coming together. And I strongly believe the Spirit of God will connect us. And we're going to worship the Lord with one accord. Hallelujah. Today, the world is celebrating love. Everywhere, all around the globe, the world is celebrating the love. But I believe we are the ones should celebrate the love. Because we have seen the true love on the cross. The one who came to this world to give up his life for you and me. Shed his blood to give us eternal life, eternity. Oh, that is the reckless love we should celebrate. Not only this day. As long as I live. Psalmist explains like this in the verse. As long as I live, I will worship the Lord. As long as I breathe, I will praise the Lord. Oh, yes. Oh, let us worship the love. The true love. Reckless love. The real love. The everlasting love. Let us all close our eyes. Oh, let's welcome the presence of the Lord in our midst. We're going to worship Him with the truth and the Spirit. Thank you, Lord. Jesus, we come into your awesome presence, loving and sweet presence, Lord. Lord, cleanse us, sanctify us once again. Lord, fill us with the Spirit of anointing. Let our praise and thanksgiving be acceptable before you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You are in our midst. When we call upon your name, when we gather together to praise your name, Lord, you are in our midst, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. We glorify you. We want to honor you. We want to submit the rest of the moment into your mighty hands. Lord, you speak to us. Help us to feel your presence, Lord. Wherever we are. Thank you, Lord. Fill us once again. Anoint us, Lord, with your worship anointing. Anoint us with your worship anointing, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We give you all the glory and honor. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Scripture says like this, because his love is better than life, my lips will glorify him. Hallelujah. We're going to glorify him because his love, hallelujah, not this worldly love, God's love, that true love is more than life. So I will praise him. My lips will glorify him. Join together. Put your hands together. We're going to worship the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord.
I will worship
with all of my praise,
all of my heart,
and I will praise you with all of my strength,
all of my strength,
and I will seek you all of my day,
all of my day,
and I will follow all of your ways, all your ways. Worship, I will give you all my praise. You alone, I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. and I will bow down. Will you ask
him?
And I will serve you. Give you everything. Give you everything. I will lift you
up.
My eyes to your throne. And I will trust you. Oh, I will trust you alone.
Trust you alone.
So I will give you all my worship. Worship with all of my heart,
all of my heart.
And
I will praise you
with all of my strength, all my strength.
I will seek you
all of my days,
all of my days.
And I will follow all of your ways. I will give you all my worship.
I will give you all my praise.
You alone, alone to worship.
You alone are worthy of mine.
And I will give
you all my worship.
I will give you all my praise.
You alone.
I will bow down. Oh, hail you asking. And I will serve you. Give you everything. Give you everything. I will lift up my eyes to your throne. And I will trust you. I will trust you alone. I will give you all my worship,
and I will give you all my praise.
You alone, you alone are worthy of mine. So I will give you all my worship,
so I will give you all my praise.
You alone,
I want to worship.
You alone. Church, put your hands together. Say, praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you, and hope is stirring, hearts are burning for you. We long for you. When we see you, when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away.
Hosanna, Hosanna.
And you are the God who saves us. Of all our praises,
Hosanna, Hosanna.
Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Oh, hear the sound of. We turn to you in your kingdom, and in your kingdom, broken lives are made new. You make us new, 'cause when we see you. And in your presence, all our fears was to washed away. Presence, all our fears are washed away. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. All our praise, Hosanna,
Hosanna.
Lord, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, we worship you, Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna, 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 Hosanna. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day, yes, Lord. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. Lord, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Oh, Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, we thank you for the wonderful moments here, Father, Lord Jesus. We thank you for this wonderful presence, oh, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, we give you all the glory, Father Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, we worship you, Father, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we ask you, Lord Jesus. Lord, we welcome you, Holy Spirit, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Lord, your name above all names, you're worthy to be praised, so Father, Lord. Jesus, hallelujah. Lord, thank you for this wonderful worship, Jesus. Lord, we worship you, Lord, hallelujah. Church, let us all remain in silence. Just close our eyes and say, oh, Jesus, we welcome you, Holy Spirit. Lord, we welcome you in our midst, Lord. Lord, come have your way in us. Lord, come glorified in our worship. Oh, Lord, we give you all the glory, Father.
You alone are worthy to be praised, O Father, Lord. Bible says in Isaiah chapter 41, so do not fear, I am with you. And do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you, and I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Lord, thank you for the courageous words and scriptures that you've given to us, Father. Lord, thank you for the cross. And thank you for the price that you paid on that cross for us, so Father, Lord. Lord, thank you for the cross, Lord. Lord, thank you for the price you oh, bearing all my sin and shame, in love you came and gave amazing grace. Oh, thank you for this love, Lord, and thank you for the nail-pierced hand. Wash me and your cleanse. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. It's worthy is the Lamb, the seated on the throne.
Oh yes, Lord.
He's crowned you now with many crowns. You reign. The darling of heaven crucified. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Well, thank you for the cross, Lord. Well, thank you for the sin and shame, in love you came and gave amazing grace. This world is the last, seated on the throne. Oh, crown you now with many crowns. Worthy is the Lamb.
Celebrate the love of Jesus. Can we celebrate Jesus Christ? Oh yes, the name above all the name. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is the only Lord and Savior. Oh yes, hallelujah. Oh come on church. My brother, my sister, hallelujah. Shout out loud, hallelujah. Shout for joy of the Lord. Shout for joy of the Lord. Hallelujah. Let his name be lifted up. Hallelujah.
You're the name above all names. You are worthy.
You are worthy. Oh, there is none like you, Lord Jesus. My heart. Hallelujah. Sing you forever and ever. My heart will sing you. Glorify you, magnify you, Lord Jesus, forever. Come on, church, hallelujah. Oshana kana saradiere. Makora bashaka lamatana raga. How great, hallelujah. Oh, what a powerful presence of God.
King, hallelujah. Oh, he's the soon and coming King.
Oh, come, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
Oh, word, oh, she's the
every eyes closed, worshiping. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb of God. Worthy is the Lamb of God. Come on, church. Life to give you hope in the hopeless situation. The darling of heaven is crucified. The treasure of heaven is crucified. Hallelujah. Worthy is the Lamb. Every eye lifted high. Worthy is the Lamb. Every eye lifted high. Every eye closed. Hallelujah. Lift up the name of Jesus.
Seated
I am lifted up.
worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. There is none like Him. Thank you, Lord. We glorify you. Lord, we praise your name for your powerful acts. We glorify you, we magnify you for your surpassing greatness, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, we just want to surrender ourselves at your loving feet, Father Lord. Let your name be alone glorified. Let your name be alone lifted high. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Once again, I welcome you all and I greet you all. Hallelujah. In the name of our Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. God is so good to us. Hallelujah. All the time, He is good. Hallelujah. Our God loves, His love is endureth forever. His love is steadfast love. God's love is everlasting love. Sometimes we see rough seasons in our life, but still He is good to us because He can bring good out of evil. Even from your difficult situation, even from your worst situation, God can bring good out of evil. Hallelujah. That is the power of the Lord. I just want to run through a few quick announcements. We have our Bible study every Friday in Zoom at 8 o'clock. And we have a 40 days prayer starting from this Wednesday. So please do join us in the Zoom. And we have our language service at 8:45 and we have our English service at half 1. Please do join in all the ministries, and if you have any prayer requests, please do send us your prayer requests. We are ready to pray for you, and I glorify the Lord. I give thanks to the Lord for all the testimonies and witness that we are hearing, that you are sharing with us. God is great. Hallelujah. We are glorifying Him for the surpassing greatness. Hallelujah. He is great and He is greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. The world is celebrating the romantic love today, but I want to tell you this, the church should celebrate, hallelujah, the agape love of God, hallelujah. The one, hallelujah, we should cherish the love of God, hallelujah, all the time. As long as we live, we should celebrate the love of God. We should thank, we should be thankful, hallelujah, for the love, for the praise, what God has paid for us. And this is the time to listen to the word of the Lord. I just want to welcome Pauline Matthew and to share the word of the Lord. Put your hands together and welcome Pauline.
Praise the Lord. The Lord is good and His mercies endureth forever. The Lord has been so good to us in all these times of uncertainties, in times that we didn't know what is ahead of us. But He's been so good to us. Every moment of our life, we can depend on a person who is dependable, who is trustable. And we have Jesus who is always there for us. No matter what, how things can turn around, whatever might happen, but we have a God to rejoice. We have a God to be boastful about. We have a person who is always lovable to us. And even as Pastor said, you know, today is the day that the whole world is praising and is embracing the love and is celebrating the love. But you know what? We have the greatest love that was ever manifested. The greatest love that was ever shown on the earth. And that is the love of Father. As word says, you know what? For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. He loved us so much. Word says that He loved us first. For mankind to know what love is, it is because He loved us first. We knew what love is only after Father showed us what love is. And you know what the word says that? For scarcely one might die for a righteous man. Perhaps maybe a good man would die, would even dare to die. But God commandeth His love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We were sinners. We were far away from the righteousness of God. We could never equate. We could never come any closer to the love, to the perfection, to the righteousness of God. But Father, He loved us so much that He couldn't withhold His only Son, that He loved Him so much. He loved us so much that He could not even withhold the only Son, and He sent this only Son, Christ Jesus, for us to die on the cross in my place, in your place. And that is how He showed His love. He loved us first before we could ever love Him. We all say, I love Jesus, I love God. But you know what? It is not us. It is not my love that I can boast upon. Because this love that I have for Him is nothing compared to the love that He has manifested on the cross. Have you ever wondered how Father would have felt when His only Son was hanging on the cross? He was betrayed, He was mocked, and He was in this flood of blood, all alone. He was defenseless. You might be wondering, you know what, I want to defend my cause, I want to defend my point, I want to fight back, I want to defend. But you know what? For you to be defended, Jesus died on the cross. So defenseless He was hanging there, that He has taken the curse, He has taken the burden, He has taken the punishment that you and me, we are supposed to be on the cross. But Father, He loved you and me so much that He said that I will sacrifice my only Son, who doesn't know sin, who is sinless. He is the righteousness of God. But God decided that I love you, I love my son, I love my daughter so much that I'm going to redeem, even if it has to die, even if it has to be a stage where somebody has to die on the cross. He said, no matter what, even if it takes for me to die on the cross, I will do that in order to save my son, in order to have my son and my daughter right with me. I want to love. I want to die on the cross in order to bring my son and my daughter closest to me. And you know what? God's love for you is never based on your performance. World will validate you based on what you do, how you perform. But God's love for you is never ever based on how good you perform. Because man's assessment, man's validation is how good you perform. What do you do so that they can be benefited? But the love of God is never validated based on how you perform. Because the word says that man looks at your outward, but God looks at your heart. He says that in 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7, He says, man, he looks at your outside. He sees how much you perform, how good you are, how beautiful you look, what efficiencies you have, what qualifications you have. But this morning, I want to say, as you're looking, you know what, out there in the world, there's so much need for appreciation, so much need to be loved. There's so much need to be accepted and approved by men. We see how we perform in our social media. How many likes, how many people are following us on the social media. And that is how we validate how good I am, how qualified I am. But I want to tell you, God's love for you is never based on how good you perform. Because God is looking at your heart. Man may look at you, he might say, you know what, you're not good enough. You're not qualified. You're not prepared enough. You know what? You're not the right person for this season, for this time, for doing this. But God's word this month, it says, 2 Chronicles chapter 3, verse 5, it says, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. My qualification is God. My qualification is God, because I don't have qualification. I'm not qualified. I'm not righteous. I'm not good enough. I'm not perfect. But God is not looking for a person who is perfect and qualified. He's looking for people who are not perfect. He is looking at your heart. It is your heart that matters. People will be more focused on how and what you do so that they will be benefited. But God is not looking at how good, how qualified you are. And you know what? A lot of people's actions make us feel dirty and ashamed that we are not good enough, that I don't carry what it takes. Because man's words might whisper in your ears to say that, look, you're not qualified. You're not good enough. You're not perfect enough to do this. But I want to tell you, don't listen to those words, which will only condemn you and tear you down. Because what God says, and God's opinion is more than ever important. And God says that you are His perfect masterpiece. You are His bride. You are the most precious. You are called to be a conqueror. You are His son and you are His daughter. He has made you in the image of you. And you are the greatest and the precious that He ever holds. And what God says and what God's opinion, that matters more than anybody else's opinion. When you look for validation at men, you won't get that. Because they cannot validate you, because they themselves are struggling with that. They themselves are struggling with insecurities. They are struggling with their inferiority. But when you look at your validation at people who are not validated themselves, you'll be condemned. You'll be put to shame. But you have to look at your validation in Christ. Because He is our righteousness. He is our righteousness. He has made you righteous because of what He has done on the cross. He's not looking at perfect people. You might be thinking, maybe when I get over all these weaknesses, maybe when I qualify, maybe when I get a degree, maybe when I come out of a college, maybe when I study, maybe when I get married, maybe when I have children, maybe when I get a house, maybe when I get self-sufficient, I'll be acceptable and approved by people. But I'm telling you this evening, your approval, your acceptance is from God Almighty alone, and that alone matters. When He died on the cross, when He shed every drop of His blood, He remembered you. He knows you. He has called you by your name. Even before He laid the foundations of the earth, He knew you. He knew your weaknesses, where you will fall, where you will stumble, what are your weaknesses. He knew everything. He is not looking for perfect people. When Jesus chose His disciples, He wasn't looking for perfect people. He chose people who are just ordinary people, fishermen, tax collector. He chose people who are nothing in front of the eyes of this world. This world might have said, Jesus is not a good recruiter. He didn't have a good HR. Because look at the disciples, how He has selected. He chose the people who are rejected by God, rejected by the world. They are just ordinary fishermen. They were not educated. They were not qualified. They didn't have any skill set. They didn't have a family background. They were not brought up in a Christian family. They had flaws. They had weaknesses. And they had difficulties. But in spite of all that, how did Jesus select His disciples? He chose them because of their heart. When you have a heart that is always pleasing God, you have a heart that wants only to please God, not man. When you try to please men, you will only end up in frustration and discouragement. Because you can never ever please men, because they themselves are insufficient and inferior, and they don't have the confidence, they don't love themselves, they are struggling with their own insecurities. And who are you trying to please? When you have a heart, see there you say that, I want to please you, Lord. And that is the heart God is looking for. God loves people who are insecure. God loves people who are not qualified. Because the word says that He qualifies the unqualified. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27, it says, God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And He has chosen the weak things so He can confound which are mighty. What a contrast. You know what? When Samuel was there choosing the king of Israel, he was looking at the brothers of David. David was not even qualified to stand among the selection group. There's a full row of men, his brothers, who have been chosen to at least come to the selection process. And David was not even chosen to be stand in the selection process. And Samuel is looking at his brothers. He looks at the man who is tall and he's gigantic. He has a good physique and he has an adorable and admirable face and personality, and says maybe he's the king. But you know what God said? God said to Samuel, I'm not looking at the outward appearance. I'm looking at his heart. Maybe you have a heart that is not, you know what, perfect. You might fall. You might make mistakes. You might have weaknesses. But when you have a God, when you have a heart that wants to please God, when you have a deep desire in you that you want to honor God in everything and everything that you do, and that is what pleases God. God pleases, is pleased with a heart that wants to honor Him. Even with the little that you have, even with the little strength that you have, when you want to please God, when you want to honor God, God is more pleased with a heart that wants to please Him. Hallelujah. When you look at people, they will only discourage you. People might say that, you know what, you have mistakes, you have weaknesses, you are still angry, you are still giving out. But you know what, the truth is, when people are so busy looking at others, they forget the big planks that they carry in their own eye. They're looking at the small things others carry. But the love of God is so strong and so wide, so big, so ununderstandable. You can never understand the love of God, which is so big and wide, which is more than all the weaknesses, more than all the flaws, more than all the difficulties and trials, and all the weaknesses that you carry in your whole life. His love is more than enough, is big enough, is sufficient enough to cover all your weaknesses and flaws. That is the love that we have. And we are the people more than everyone on this earth to celebrate the love. Because the love of Jesus, the love of Father God, is the love that was ever manifested. It's the greatest love that was ever manifested on earth. In 2 Chronicles 16:9, it says, the eyes of the Lord are searching on the earth to show Himself strong in those whose hearts are turned perfect. He says God's eyes are looking over the earth to see whose heart is turned right with Him. So He can manifest Himself. He can show Himself stronger in them. He is not looking at perfect people. He is not looking at people who are qualified, who are the best. But He is looking at people who are weak, who have been chosen, who have been disqualified by earth as weak and disqualified. But we have a God who's looking for those people, because the word says that His power, His strength shall be manifested in our weaknesses. And therefore Paul says that I can boast more than ever over my weaknesses, because I know in my weaknesses that Christ is manifested in me. When I'm good enough, I don't need Christ, isn't it? Because I can boast myself, I can show my qualification, I can show my skills, I can show how good I am. And that is not the beauty. The beauty is when you are weak, when you are disqualified, when you are rejected, when people don't approve you and validate you. And that is the kind of people God is searching for. Because His word says that He's looking for people who are weak, so that He can show Himself, He can display His power in them, because their heart is in right. Their heart is right to God. And that is what God is searching for. And when Jesus, we had baptism in our church, and I want to say to people who are planning to take baptism or who have already taken baptism, you know what, when Jesus went all the way to Jordan, and He immersed Himself and He came out. We see that Father God validates His Son. And He says, this is my Son, in Him I'm well pleased. Jesus hasn't performed any miracles yet. Jesus hasn't gone out to do His ministry. He hasn't performed anything. There's no miracles. He hasn't made any impact in the earth yet. But God validates Jesus even before the start of His ministry. Are you waiting? Maybe if I do miracles, maybe if I perform well, maybe if I earn a good salary, maybe if I get a big house, maybe if I go to that extent, maybe if I reach those goals, people might approve me and qualify me. No, they will not. Even if you have reached the highest goals, people will never validate you. People will never accept and approve you. But more than people's acceptance and approval, it is God's approval that matters. Because He called you, He knows you, He created you, and He is the one who's going to lift you. He is the one who's going to go before you, and He is going to manifest His glory. And therefore, His opinion, His approval, His validation is what we need. And before Jesus performed any miracle, we see Father God, the heavens opened and Holy Spirit descended upon like a dove. And we hear Father God speaking out loud saying that, "This is my Son, whom I'm well pleased." God is going to validate you even before you step out. That is what I'm trying to say. You don't have to prove yourself. Enough of proving. All these years you have proved enough. All these years you have spoken good about yourself. All these years you are tired of proving yourself to people around you, with you, and against you. You have proved yourself enough. But you couldn't prove you enough. You know what? Whatever you try to prove, people won't validate you. Enough of proving. But this year God is saying that I'm going to prove myself. I'm going to prove my son, my daughter. Because you don't have to prove anything. I am weak. You can say, "Yes, I am weak. Yes, I'm not qualified. Yes, I'm not sufficient." But I have a God who can manifest His strength, His glory, His power in me, in my very weaknesses. And that is the beauty. And that is the beauty. God is not looking at your best performances. God is not at all looking at people who can perform best. But we have a God. We have a Father who loves you even before you have performed. And you know what? David did not perform anything to be qualified as a king. He hasn't performed anything yet. He was just a small boy. All he knew was praising Him and worshiping Him and give Him glory. All that David knew was he was just, his heart was connected. His heart was aligned with Father. All David knew was to glorify God, sing praises unto Him. That's all David did. He did not prove himself before men, before his brothers, before his sisters, before his family. He did not perform anything. But God approved David even before he performed. Because when you look out for people, maybe if David would have looked for the approval of his brothers, he wouldn't have reached where he was supposed to. Because his brother, even in the battlefield, we say that his brother is condemning David. "What are you up to? You're not supposed to be here." But you know what David did? The word says that he turned his head. What did he do? He wasn't there proving himself to his brother. He wasn't explaining how good he was to his brother. He wasn't explaining his skill set to his brother. Instead, the word says that he turned his head. What does it mean? You don't have to prove yourself. You don't have to explain people. You don't have to prove how good you are to people, because they are not the ones to validate you. They are not the ones to accept and approve you. It is God Almighty who has to approve you and validate you. And He will do that even before you perform anything. Even before you go out and do great and awesome things. Because the word says that He knows you and He has called you even before He laid the foundations of the earth. And we have a God who has manifested His love, His greatest love, even while we were sinners. We haven't performed. I'm not good enough. Because you know what? If you try to perform good, if you try to reach a goal where you'll be perfect, and then you say, "Maybe now people will validate me, or people will accept and approve me," you can never reach that. Because we are living in this human life where we can never reach a perfection, where we can never reach the righteousness of God. And that is why Father said, "Look, I'm going to send my own son, who is the righteousness, who is the perfect righteousness, in order to make my son and daughter righteous. And we find our perfection in Christ Jesus. We find our righteousness in Christ Jesus, because he is our righteousness. He is our perfection. So you can never reach that state and say, now I'm perfect. No, there'll be always something that needs to be corrected. There will be always something to correct, always something to be improved. So therefore, even while we were sinners, as God loved us, we need to accept others. Nobody can say, you know what, I'm so perfect that I cannot adjust with you. You are doing things wrong. This is not how it should be done. It is easy. Because when you carry this big plank in your eye, you don't have time looking at the strengths, looking at the love, looking at Christ manifested in your brothers and sisters. It is time that we accept our brothers and sisters and forgive them as Christ did for us. We should all remember, we are the clay and Jesus Christ is our potter. And when you are in potter's hand, you are still clay. And it is potter's work. It is potter's job to make us perfect. We cannot make ourselves perfect. It is potter who has to make ourselves perfect. As long as you stay in the hands of the perfect potter, you are fine. Because people might say that, you know what, you have a crack there, you have a stone there, you don't have the perfect shape. That's all right. That's all right. Because it is not them who's going to validate you. It is not them who's going to help you or lift you up when you fall. It is Christ, the potter. He is the one to give you a shape. He is the one to bring you up. Even when the clay is marred in the potter's hand, the potter is so beautiful, is so loving, that he does not throw away the clay. But instead, the word says that he makes the pot into a better one, as he pleases. And all we need to do is, like the clay, we need to stay between the hands of the potter, because he will be the one to shape you, to break you, to clean you, to fill you and use you. So my part is, yes, I am weak. Yes, I'm not good enough. Yes, I'm not qualified. Yes, I'm not perfect, but I decide to submit myself in the hands of the perfect potter. He is the creator and he creates me. He will create me, and when he creates, it's perfect. And that's what David did. David wasn't in a hurry to prove himself. David wasn't rushing to show off his skill sets. He never said, look, to his brothers or to his family. He said, look, I've done this. This is my profile. This is my data. Look what I've done. This is my past. This is my qualification. He never even tried to do that. Word says that he just turned around and he said, what will be done for the man who is going to fight against this Philistine? And he was focused. His eyes were focused on what God has made. And he had the zeal. He said, look, I'm going to go in the strength that he has given me. And that's what he did for Goliath. He did for David. He said, go in the strength that you have. And that's what he did in Judges for Gideon. Gideon was still in the threshing floor. He is not a warrior. He is not a man of strength. He was just a timid guy who was trying to do what he can do. Because the Midianites were so strong. The Israelites were surrounded by such powerful Midianites who had complete control over Israel. And in that little strength that Gideon had, he said, let me go and thresh. This is what I can do. And you see, the angel of God comes to Gideon and he said, you man of valor. You and me, we would never call such a person like that. We would say, oh, you timid man. Oh, man, you look what you're doing. But you see what Jesus said. God called Gideon, you man of valor. He has not performed anything. He has even not gone out, or he has not even made up his mind to go and fight against the Midianites. He was so timid. He said, look, my family is nothing. We are the very weakest family. And even in my weakest family, I'm nothing. I'm just an ordinary guy who doesn't even have any approval or validation. But angel of God calls Gideon, you man of valor, even before he performed anything. Saul, you know, God chose Saul. And Saul was a man who was the tallest among all the Israel. He had the physique that everybody knew that he is the king. Outward, he has the best appearance. Outward, he has the best skill set. He was the best. Everybody knew when they saw Saul, they knew that he is the king because he was so good outwards. But he got rejected because his heart wasn't in line with Christ. His heart wasn't in line in pleasing God. He wanted to please himself. He wanted to please his desire. He wanted to look good in front of people. We see Saul is going and begging Samuel, if you don't come with me, people will go away. Please come with me. Please come and worship the Lord with me so that people can accept me, so that people can approve and validate me. So his eyes and his heart was over people's approval and validation. But you see, David, he didn't have a big physique. He didn't have qualification. He wasn't from a royal family. He didn't have any family background. There was nothing that he can boast upon. All David knew was to worship the Lord. And all David knew was to love the Lord. And he took the zeal. He had the zeal for God. And he never did anything for himself. All he could think of is God. And he wanted to please God. And you know what? It's such a contrast. We have someone who is so, outwardly the best. He had the best appearance. He was so good outwards. And we have a guy who was only a small guy. And he didn't have the best appearance. He was just an ordinary kid. But this is what the world will see. This is what you and me will see, because this is what we can see. But there's something that nobody can see. That is the heart of the person. And that's why the word says that, God says in 1 Samuel, he says, you look at outside, but I look at the heart. And God saw the hearts of Saul and David. And it was Saul's heart that was not pleasing God. The primary importance of Saul was not pleasing God or honoring God. His heart was more towards the men. He wants men's approval and validation. But see, we have David, who had a heart who only wanted to please God, honor God, worship God, exalt God, and lift God up. And that is what God was pleased with. And this man, God has given us this word that our sufficiency is in him. And you know what? He is our sufficiency. He is our strength. And how do we get qualified? What qualifies us? How do we know that we are qualified? Ephesians 2:8 says, for by grace ye are saved through faith. And that is not us by ourselves. It is the gift of God. So what qualifies us? We know that we are weak. We are not perfect people. We have flaws. We have difficulties, we have trials. We make commitment, Lord, hereafter I won't do that, but yet we fall again. We make mistakes, we sin. God is not against your sins. God is not against you. He only dislikes the sins. He loves the sinner. He loves you and me. He knows that we will fall. He knows our difficulties. He knows our weaknesses. So what qualifies us in front of God? It is His grace that qualifies us. It is His grace that makes us perfect. It is His grace that makes us righteous and acceptable before Father. That we need to tap into this grace. Lord, I am weak. I'm not perfect. I have flaws and difficulties. But I want to reach out to this grace. I want this grace which is beyond boundaries, which is beyond what I can take. I want this grace to cover me. So that, Lord, your grace, your perfection, your power will perfect me. It will cover me and it will make me in good standing right before God. So this grace of God, it is what makes us more than conquerors. It is what that gives us the sufficiency. And that is what made Gideon man of valor. And you know what? God calls for people who are not perfect, But he looks for a heart that wants to please God. And we see this right throughout the Bible, where God qualifies people who are not qualified. And right throughout the Bible, we see that he always looks for people who are weak, who are not perfect, who doesn't have qualities, who doesn't have any talents, who are not sufficient in the eyes of the world. He always looks for these kind of people. And that is what word says, that his eyes are always on people who are not strong enough so that he can manifest his power and his glory on us. And when there is opposition, when people don't accept you or people don't qualify you, we feel condemned. We feel that I'm not good enough to do this. But God is saying to you, it is me that I'm going to validate you, because I have made you wonderfully. You have been created in the image of me. I have called you my son and daughter. If you can make up your heart to say, Lord, it is not man's approval. It is your approval that I'm seeking. And when your word says that I'm approved, I've been accepted, and I've been validated by you, that's the only thing that I want. And when you say that, you will be in the potter's hand, and he will perfect you, and he will give you the right shape. No matter how many times you fall, his hands are always there to catch you. And he will hold you, and he will bring you through till the end. All you need to do is give yourself into his hands. Because the one who has manifested the greatest love is alive even today. He is not a dead God. He is alive. The one who died on the cross for your sins and my sins is alive even today. And he wants to extend. He wants to show his love to you and me. Will you come to Jesus? His love is so big. His love is beyond your sins and your mistakes and your flaws and your weaknesses. He can cover all your iniquities under his precious love, under his precious grace. Will you join with me and say, Lord, I want you. I want your approval more than anything. I want your qualification. I want your validation for me. Will you say, Lord, I give myself to you. You know what, Jesus, he's the prince and he's the darling of heaven. When he can come down to my level and he can die for me on the cross, what more I can ask for? He has done everything. When he said that it's finished on the cross, my qualification is finished. My validation is finished. My rejection is done. He has already accepted me. When his love, his power is enough to carry me, it is enough to carry you. Hallelujah. Let's be encouraged. We have a God. We have a Father who has made us in his image. When he created me, he was happy. When he created you, he was happy. He wasn't sad. You are never a mistake. I'm never a mistake. I'm created in his image. And therefore, all that Christ Jesus has is mine. All his power, all his magnificence is mine and is yours. And therefore, let's make a decision to give ourselves to God. And he will qualify you and he will equip you, because your qualification is from him, through him. And he is going to manifest his love and his power in your life through you. He's going to be a blessing for many others. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this wonderful time, Lord God. Lord, we know and we believe that, Lord God, you are the one who's going to qualify us. No matter what, Father God, no matter what men might condemn, might put us down and tear us down. But we have a good news that, Lord, you have died for us on the cross in order to validate me, in order to make me qualified. Lord, I pray, Father God, even as people are watching, Lord God, I pray that you will speak to their hearts to say that you are their strength in their weaknesses. We can never wait for a time where we can reach perfection and be approved and accepted by people. But Father, even as I'm in your hands, even as you're molding me, even as you're preparing me for perfection, Lord, I want to give myself to you, to your hands, to your perfect hands of Father God. Lord God, I pray even as young people, young men and women who are watching, Father God, that we will not be carried away. We will not be condemned by our weaknesses. We will not be condemned by our flaws. But Father, we will depend on your righteousness, because it is your righteousness that makes us righteous. It is your power that gives us power. And Lord, I pray that your grace will cover each and every person who's hearing this voice and watching this. Father, I pray that your abounding grace, amazing grace of Father God, which is beyond our human understanding, will cover them, O Father God, and give them the confidence in you, because you are our confidence. You are our strength, O Father God. You are our qualification in Christ Jesus. And Lord, thank you for your word. And thank you for the love that you have displayed on the cross. Thank you for the love that you have displayed, O Father. Lord, even Father God, even while we were sinners, even while we were in our weaknesses, Lord, you loved us. You first loved us so that we know what love is. Lord, you showed us what love is. And Father, we love you and we depend on you. We trust you, O Father God. Lord, help us to be strengthened in you, because you are our everything. And Lord, you are our qualification. And thank you, Master, we pray for people who are in pain, who are in sickness, and Lord, who are in struggles and difficulties and rejection. Father, I pray that your love will touch them. Lord, your love will touch them in their very circumstances. And Father, I pray that whoever is suffering with pain, Lord, let their pain be, Father God, removed in the name of Jesus. Father, no matter how much medicine and whatever things that we do, Lord, it is only your healing touch, only your power that can take away the pain. Father, we pray for everyone who are struggling in their weaknesses, in their difficulties, in their rejection. Father, I pray that, Lord God, your power will approve them. Your grace will approve them. Lord, your hands are wide open to accept them, O Father God. Lord, give them a heart to come to you, to seek you. And Lord, give them the courage to reach out to you, Father God. Lord, let your love touch your people, O Father God. And Lord, we pray for every people who are going through rough times. Lord, let your strength be with them. Lord, cover them, O Father God. Strengthen them. Lord, guard them, O Father God. Give them the strength that they need to pass through this difficult situation. Lord, I pray for people who are struggling with finances. Lord, I pray that your power, your strength, your provision, Father God, will meet all their needs. And Lord, even during this week, I pray that every decision that they take, oh Father God, every people that they meet, every conversation that they make, Father, I pray that your hand of counsel, your hand of protection will be with them to guide them and guard them and give them the right counsel to make the right decision. Father, we give every one of us into your hands. You protect us and guide us and take care of us. Let your name alone be glorified. Let you alone be glorified in our lives. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And amen.